1966年，我16岁，我们学校呢1000多个学生选了20个代表，我是其中一个。老师同学对我相信信任，让我有个荣誉去北京见毛主席。这是我16岁时候到北京去见毛主席，这是毛主席像嘛？这个天安门，
你见到
毛？两次见了毛主席。可以这样意思，为什么道理呢？因为历史啊是一个演变，啊，是个演变的过程，不断的发展过程。也许某个阶段，人们的感受，啊，包括这个社会给予的是不同的感受。因为毛泽东时代，那是一个体现民主，是吧？体现社会进步，体现平等，最主要平等。我想补充一点，又讲到电影呢，因为电影呢是一个综合艺术，它就是不受这个国界的这个限制，啊，包括每个国家电影都可以进行交流。所以除了电影之外，我还收藏了电影机，啊，电影海报、电影画报、电影连环画。这是一个综合类的一个艺术种类，所以说对印度历史啊、印度文化，包括印度民族英雄，比如甘地啊，这些过去的尼赫鲁总理和我们国家的时候外交的活动，当时经常见报的。后来呢，电影的看的就是新闻纪录片看的多，因为我们国家就是和印度的文化交流啊是比较熟悉，也很崇拜这个大国，因为它的人口仅次于中国。因为我以前那个因为我比较喜欢收藏历史、报纸、电影。以前印度电影我小时候很喜欢看的，因为我妈妈喜欢印度电影，喜欢印度电影的音乐和歌曲，到处流浪啊，到处流浪，这首歌曲，哎。
Leo Dubao collects images of a time not very long ago. The China I visit now is a very different place.We have seen the images of its monumental change in the last 3 decades through many sources, including film. I was here a few years ago as a participant in a film festival. It was called You Don't Belong, Pasts and Futures of Indian Cinema.It featured documentary, experimental video, and fiction films. 10 filmmakers and scholars were part of this event, which was held in 4 cities in mainland China, Hong Kong, and Taiwan. The festival was organized by West Heavens Project, which is a cultural program that works on creating a dialogue between the arts and academic circuits of India and China.
Activities, creative activities, started with frustrations. And my frustration is really with this loss of grasp of this contact with Chinese history, the Chinese soil of culture, the soil of nourishment. And because of that, we get indigestion from what is coming in from the outside. How do you deal with indigestion? And I thought India would be the best medicine. But dealing with this,of course also implies a kind of optimism. And one cannot be a curator without being optimistic. I think that is the first criteria. So I'm basically practicing my trade.
What happened was the creation of Johnson's term. The literary term should be called 西天, West Heaven and Chinese soil or Chinese earth, abbreviated in English as West Heaven.
Firstly, I wanted to address the issue of the West. In China, there is no foreign culture that is as important as the West. So it is either China West or East and West. But in popular imagination, we've forgotten there's actually another West which everybody speaks about all the time in China, which is the West Heavens. And of course, the West Heavens was the old Chinese name for India, where the sutras came from. I also wanted to call it West Heavens in the plural to open up to diverse cultural sources and also diverse imaginations about the world. Chinese people think of India as the land of Buddha, but of course it is 2,000 years past. But what is important in China today is really the intellectual life, the vigor, and the relevance of Indian contemporary thought, which is sorely lacking in China. The interest in contemporary thought is practically exclusively directed at Western intellectual thought.
Until I went to the US, suddenly became clear it's so limited, because I met several students in those spaces, but we actually never talked to each other. Classic is you meet in London, Paris, New York, and so on. So when I came back, late 1980s, so I saw there's something entirely wrong with the entire system in Taiwan, because it's so Americanized.
I worked in the film museum as a programmer. I doing some film screening, art film screening, and some film festivals, and some kind of activities, lectures, exhibitions, some kind of like that. First, I just watched one or two films for not belong to.
You don't belong.
You don't belong. Okay. And then I found that there have got a lot of work to watch those films, to discuss with them, and actually you discuss about our issues. It's like that.
Which are the films, or which is the film that you liked?
Citizenry, 1989. But you don't feel it belongs to any time of production, or it is for any specific culture of audience, although it is very specifically Indian music and Indian story. This is a film division film, yeah? And this is something that an ideal propaganda film really want to achieve, but they can hardly achieve. Anybody on the street, if you just ask them this question, what do you think about India? Then older generation, they will talk about Buddhism. And I think some of them will have some impression of Nehru, because Nehru was very much in the memory of people above 70s. Some of them will talk about Gandhi. And Tagore, I think many people will talk about Tagore because it's in the textbook.
I told them that one day we'll see the importance, and now I can finish this operation in 45 seconds.
就他的一些电影，在故事之外还有一层。 这一层其实是我们中国的电影。对，就对，老巴哈里的世界就对，咱们好，speed的，咱们来个，对，老巴哈里的世界，让阿玛提的世界。
另外一个就是一个跳舞的一个男的，很厉害，有点中年男子，但是他跳的全都是古老的印度的古老的那个舞蹈，然后呢，最后呢，他的一个在一个废墟上，他就在那跳，然后呢，太阳就落山了，然后呢，他就在那跳跳，最后他自己就不动了，就那样的。这个里头的寓意，我自己内心简直是感慨万分，而且让我非常惊奇的是，因为这个片子它是拍于50年代。
然后小时候就有这个印象了，觉得感觉还是蛮喜欢的，而且是载歌载舞的，对吧？这种形式。在那之后呢，的确是有一段时间是没有接触到印度电影，对吧？直到我看那个《阿育王》，直到看《阿育王》，我是喜欢了那个夏洛克汉，然后我就成为他的忠实粉丝。
阿育王都很久了。
是有和对对对对对对对对，当中肯定是断了，我估计断了10年20年都有，对对对对。阿育王这个电影我看了之后，我当时就这个感觉，好像他这个气势啊，就是同样是，我们可以称呼它为史诗电影吧。
Ashoka, it's about Ashoka. I don't know the film title. It's called Ashoka, yeah.
但是印度电影它片长都比较长嘛。至少有2.5小时以上嘛，那些大制作片子甚至有3-4小时都有，但是它的整个的剧情它都是很丰满的，就是说这个我就感觉不错，非常不错，这是国内一些电影都是比不上的，就是说大致就是这样吧。家里也收了一些。怎么了？
什么？
知道什么？知道什么？
鬼丈夫。
哦，好。
It's a remake of a Madhuri Kaul film.
Oh, really?
Not the Raj Kapoor, no, none of the Avara
stuff.
Actually,
yeah, he said
okay.
That was the very early memory, and then there's a 20-year gap.
How come the 20-year gap?
你觉得这怎么会20年对印度电影就是我们国内没有引进还是什么原因？
对。
There's no
可能中国和印度的关系吧。
And he is guessing some bilateral relation between India and China.
但是我在看印度片子的时候会一个对照，就是拿国内的电影和印度电影对照，但我就觉得是比不上，就说比不上，而且是国内的很多电影我是有点。OK， 我是有点就是看不起，说老实话，看不起。我觉得很多不是为了电影在拍电影的，很多，
So for his perspective, he feels it's not film for the film's sake at all.
I never heard anyone say that about Bollywood films.
Shahrukh,
thank you.
Shanghai.Yu Yuan Gardens. These girls seem to think that my friend Rohan is Shah Rukh Khan. It is extremely amusing to see that we might be identified by the icons of our popular culture.
我是5岁嘅時間，嗰個時間就我家姐係去咗香港嘅，去咗香港係佢拎我翻嚟，佢係 VCR 嚟嘅，第一筆係拎我 VCR 翻嚟印度。Should I continue? I think the iconic image of the Chinese in India, globally as well, was created by Bruce Lee. Bruce Lee was, in a way, the first star to emerge from Hong Kong and stood in a way for everything that was Chinese, right, and cinematic terms. There were, of course, you know, a lot of these earlier 50s kind of socialist films that came by, but they came primarily through the embassy circuit and didn't really have a mass or a popular circulation. But Bruce Lee was the defining moment, I mean, defining in many ways, because the curse of Bruce Lee is felt by every Chinese growing up in India, right? Because you get identified as Bruce Lee, you get called Bruce Lee. Sometimes it works in your favor. So I think if you look at the continuum between the martial arts film as establishing a certain idea of Chinese-ness, a film that I remember very clearly, which broke all kinds of records at that point of time in Bangalore, was 36 Chamber of Shaolin. A very, very crucial film in establishing a certain idea of the mystical Orient with its secret martial arts knowledge, etc. And then you have the modern version of it, which is Jackie Chan as a phenomenon, followed by Jet Li. So there's that one circuit. And I think the interesting ramifications of that circuit has been felt in India, both in terms of the adoption in India of a certain genre of the martial arts adapted to Hindi cinema. So whether it's Mithun Chakraborty taking it on in his films, or it is particularly in South India, a genre of martial arts films itself. There was also a circulation of the fifth generation Chinese filmmakers, Chen Kai-gis, Farewell My Concubine, or Red Sorghum, Raise the Red Lantern, Shanghai Triad. All of these were pretty important and iconic films because they inaugurated a certain moment in the history of Chinese cinema, and you could see there the excitement around it. But that was still very limited in a way to the film festival audience. They didn't really have a mass appeal. The mass appeal really began for me with Wong Kar-wai. The critical moment for me is VCDs and DVDs. I remember the excitement around Wong Kar-wai because, you know, this was also a period of time where VCDs weren't copyable. And most of the times you never even encountered these films at first glance. You only heard about them. Someone who had been to a festival came back very excitedly talking about this new filmmaker, Wong Kar-wai, and about Happy Together. And then you itched to see the film. And finally, when you saw the film, it kind of blew you in terms of what he was doing with cinema.
Beyond the popular images created by Bruce Lee, Jackie Chan, Raj Kapoor, and Shah Rukh Khan, there lie many other stories. We visited Kunming, the capital of the Yunnan province, which is the center of independent documentary practice in China.
中国跟印度一样，曾经在这个一百年以前，实际上都处在一个就争取自己的独立。另外一方面是推翻原有的这个体制，就旧的，在中国是个帝王的体制嘛。那这样一个过程中间，在这个过程中间，当时云南由于它这个特殊的地位的话，有两个非常重要的因素，实际上我们现在在看出来。 一个是它的这个生物的多样性，一个是文化的多样性。它文化的多样性的话，就是它本身这个地方的文化是带有一个非常复杂的一些因素在里面。它既带有那个喜马拉雅文化的因素，同时也带有那个东南亚甚至一些南亚文化的因素，然后还有中国内地的文化，它几种东西在这个地方混合起来。
Thank you.
而且那个在九十年代到二就是在前十年哈、啊，基本上这个民间的这一块还可以举办比较大的一些电影节。那现在从去年开始一个重要的转折点，到现在的话，现在基本上开始转向小型的放映活动，大的电影节不太容易办。因为在中国举办电影节这个权利是属于国家的，没有任何私人和独立的机构可以举办电影节，所以大家都叫影像展，不叫电影节。那么从去年开始，影像展基本上也不能办。因为纪录片本身，独立纪录片本身，你就是一个边缘的东西，你就是边缘的，你跟主流社会是不一样的，你就要坚持你自己这个边缘的地位。就好像云南它自己就是整个中国这个大社会的一个边缘，我们非常清楚的知道我们云南就是一个边缘，我就做边缘的事情。
The You Don't Belong project was very successful in terms of its audience engagement. We started this project with Beijing. We worked with the Film Institute in Beijing.Then it went down to Guangzhou and Shanghai. Shanghai was the center of Chinese film industry until the 50s. There was a very strong cinematic imagination in Shanghai. From there, we took this to Kunming. The Kunming Documentary Festival has the most diverse and radical selection of films. Bringing a Shisha selection to Kunming merges with the experimental and cutting edge in China.
The term for film in Mandarin is Diàn-yïng. It translates into English as electric shadow, a very visual term that conjures early cinema. These shadows contain the history of a culture, often dominated by mainstream narratives. But there are always smaller, independent voices within, which talk of subtle nuances.
What is crucial, I think, to this entire India-China exchange is what, you know, to use a phrase by Thomas Alea, one of his films, Memories of Underdevelopment, you know, this idea of a memory as against certain kind of an amnesia, you might say, about that particular history. And I'm interested in the way that moving images from both these countries are able to open up a history almost unbeknownst to themselves.The simple point is that I think intelligibility, you know, making sense in a complex way is much more difficult than simply something like translation. We tend also to be somewhat self-obsessed and, you know, tend to be within a certain universe of our own making. And we will say, and we often actually say that, you know, I mean, if you want to come in,to my context and understand what I'm saying, you do it on my terms. it's a kind of a situation where actually immense amount of work has to happen in order to make mere translation acquire intelligibility. The primary focus was documentary.And I mean documentary in the fullest sense of the term as a means by which a conversation could develop. As such, I think that we were very, very quickly interested in two other phenomena, which documentary it seemed opened up for us. One was experimental video. The second was a certain sort of fictional cinema that had worked with the, you know, the reality effect of documentaries.
我们真正的青春岁月就在那个年代十多年是完全属于是荒废。那十几年，我们那个是好多岁？那个是正是十二十岁左右，66年嘛，18、19岁，20岁的时候，正是我们最饱和的时期。我们那个时候是无所事事，就这样子。那个时候是属于是整个的人都疯了，全部的人都疯了。
有啊有啊，就是比如说那个我有部片子叫《宣南鲜花录》，就拍了一个非常平凡的老太太的故事。后来我发现很多人在当时说谁愿意听一个老太太絮叨呢，那老太太又不是右派，又不是什么，又就是一个平凡的不能再平凡的人。后来我觉得因为我在印象最深的就在巴黎放过一次。那个影院坐满了，然后没有一个观众，就我上过去是厕所，中途没有人退场，也没有人那什么，反正大家看得饶有兴致。然后我觉得就个人使得那种魅力就在这儿吧，哪怕你不是说很激烈的，但是你怎么活过来的，这个东西太耐人寻味了，就是这样。
就是整个结合你的经历完了之后，你对生命你要是看法，
有啥子？我没啥子看法，看啥有啥子看有啥子？
你觉得生命是好东西还是？
好东西，生命啥子坏东西呢？
这纪录片导演太迫切的，先把自己的观点，先把自己的态度先行，就是政治态度，我是指。先行出来，这个纪录片其实给人的说服力很小，它其实是完全就是一种以那个某党的方式来反某党，你明白我的意思吗？就以宣传部的方式来反宣传部，就是说有这样就特别特别有这种概念先行的影片，主要是这个，我觉得他的意思准确的说应该是这样，因为我还是不太愿意就说到就是说。西方或者东方，我觉得这个现在已经不分了，不要分这个东西方的这个概念。对对对，但是就是说，确实纪录片有的时候会有这样。我做的时候，我也会警惕自己，不要把自己的概念强行灌输给。
大量谈提不起来89年血槽，
89年血槽，晓得一点。
这都在扭曲，所有的概念都在扭曲。然后，而我们现在要谈论的现实的禁忌有那么多。所以根本大家都不关心现实了，就是只有做纪录片的好像还是对现实比较，我觉得不关注这东西我操说不过去，其实很多都出于这种愤怒，其实还是底子骨子里边还是愤怒，只是表现方式我觉得越丰富越好，就这样。
Behind Tiananmen Square, inside the Forbidden City which we remember from Bernardo Bertolucci's The Last Emperor, propaganda filmsand the student protest of 1989. There lies a video booth where I can wear a traditional warrior costume and fly over the iconic landscapes of Beijing. I take my camera in my hand and make a selfie to add to my images of China.